Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear beautiful people out there, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Today I want to take you on a journey in our history, the beautiful history of Islam. I'm going to wrap like 14 centuries in less than an hour. That's going to be a lot, but it's going to be an enjoyable journey, so stick around. Well, I'll just give you the predominant things that took place that affected time, that affected history, and that is affecting us today. As I said many times before, my dear beautiful people, that one day when you make one decision today, it affects your life 10 years from now, 20 years from now. Look back in your past and see what kind of decision did you take that got you where you are today. And in fact, one day, 1 minute, 1 second in your life, you took a decision. And you maybe didn't think much about it. But guess what? The impact of that decision is on today. So see what it is. I'll give an example of such a decision. One day you were in your homeland, or maybe your parents were in their homeland in their original countries, and they took a decision in a split of a second that enough is enough. They don't want to live in poverty anymore. So what they did is they left their homeland. So as you can see, it was a one day or maybe a 1 minute decision. And guess what? It traveled, and now you are the result of that decision, and I am today the result of that decision, and my children are the result of that decision. So as you can see, we can take a decision and then either reap the fruits of that decision later on or get the consequences of it later on. This is why before you take any decision, every single day, make sure that you know what you're doing, namely in Islam. Because the decisions we make in Islam affect our lives today, tomorrow, after tomorrow, and also they have an eternal repercussion on what's going to happen to us when we are in Jannah someday. Our history has not always been of the shiny ones, you know. As much as I would love to tell you we Muslims have like a great history, like we've always been goodies, as a matter of fact, no. We have been extremely baddies in the time. The problem with our leaders today, both political leaders and religious leaders, is they only highlight eras of our history where we shined. But more than that, they do not reveal. So today I'm going to kind of like reveal a few things to you to understand why the West behaves the way they behave towards us, and why they do not believe in the Islam that is Islam, and why some people have a hidden agenda. Watch this space. After the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu came to power. He was there for 2.5 years. Right after him, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq died after he took a shower. And then subhanallah, he got a very nasty cold and Allah caused him to die. Right after that came Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu for 12 years, Amir al-Mu'mineen. In his time, Persia, the kingdom of Persia, the Byzantine kingdom, got knocked down by the Muslims, the Arabs. I want to say here that we did not invade them. We did not invade them. It was them who prepared an army and were getting ready to attack us. So instead of them having dinner with us, Muslims decided to have lunch with them. So this is basically what happened. It was a fight of 1 million Byzantines against 30,000 Muslims. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in 5 days' time made the Muslims win the battle. That's why Persia, Iran today are never ever happy with the Muslims. Also, one thing here, after that came Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, who also went on for over 12 years as a Khalifa, which led at the end of his life with him being murdered, wrongly murdered. The reason, Uthman radiallahu anhu was a rich man, and he would give his family, and it is known. But when some people, hypocrites at the end of the time, wanted to rebel against him, they looked for what is the excuse that we can use against him. And then they said to him two things, that he was helping himself to the wealth of the Muslims, and he was appointing only members of his family. And then they killed him, walayyadu billah, what wrong did. After that, the wall of fitna started. Just like the Pink Floyd said, just another brick in the wall. So that was the first fitna. After that, Ali radiallahu anhu was appointed as Khalifa for 5 years. And then Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, who was in Syria, the Sham today, Syria, Lebanon, Palestine, he was the governor. Uthman radiallahu anhu was of the family of Muawiyah. And this is why the Bani Umayyah wanted revenge, and Ali radiallahu anhu couldn't offer that because a lot of those killers, it became an uproar. Think of it today. For example, London, we have half London who killed Uthman and the other half are confused. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu wanted to take revenge and that was not possible. So the whole battle happens. I don't want to get in details today. I'll get into this topic one day in details. Before I move on there, the Shia, subhanAllah, what they do every year, they call Hussein, 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 Hussein. Do you know why they do Hussein? Why not Al-Hassan? Why not an Ali? Ali radiallahu anhu had 11 children, all of them boys, or at least the boys of them, 11. And do you know why the Shia always call on Hussein? And before saying that, the Shia's imams, the 12 imams, they all come from the offspring of Al-Hussein alone. Not from Al-Hassan, not from Al-Muhsin, not from Al-Abbas, not from Hilal, not from Abdullah, not from Ja'far, not from Uthman, not from Ubaydullah, not from Abu Bakr ibn Ali, not from Umar ibn Ali. Look, there are some children of Ali, they are called Umar and Abu Bakr. Can you imagine that? And the Shia, and all of them from Ali. And why it's only Al-Hussein, and why all the imams, the 12 imams of the Shia, all of them come Al-Hussein? I will tell you why, and you'll be surprised. Because Al-Hussein radiallahu anhu is the only child who married the daughter of the king Kisra, Kaiser. Yes, Dajarat, that was the king of the Iranian back then, the Persian people there. His daughter, Shahzanah, is the daughter, and Al-Hussein married her. Because his children come from her offspring. They don't care much about Al-Hussein. If the offspring come, for example, from Abu Bakr ibn Ali, and he was the one to have married the daughter of Kisra, then they would have worshipped the imams that come from his offspring. Shia are evil, iyadu billah, when it comes to all these things. Anyway, jump start. Back to the Dawla al-Amawiyya, or Umayyah. After that, Muawiyah ibn Sufyan, ibn Abi Sufyan, became the first Amir al-Mu'mineen. And that was when the Muslim world became a kingdom, not anymore Khilafah. Since that day until today, the Muslim world has never ever known a true Khalifa like that of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali. Never. After that, it became a king, then Amir al-Mu'mineen. Until like today, in Saudi Arabia, for example, it's a king. And then he's Khadim al-Haramain, al-Sharifain, and this and that. The kingdom of Bani Umayyah went for 100 and around 12 to 15 years. Between 100 and 15 years. And that was that. After that, there was another movement that started growing in the darkest of the night. Because Bani Umayyah messed up big deal. In the kingdom of Bani Umayyah, murders have been made. I'll give you an example. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu, rahimahullah, is one of the top khulafa of Bani Umayyah. He's the top of the leaders of the Bani Umayyah family. He just ruled for 2 years and a half. And he was, mashallah, even today, look at how he talk about him, it was very good. He was killed by his own family, poisoned. Poisoned, why? Because he was ruling by Islam. The ruling of Islam at any one point in existence was the superficial, like in Saudi Arabia. We superficially rule by Islam, but when you go deep into it, it's got nothing to it, it's just an umbrella. But in any case, the Dawla al-Abbasiyya started. And when the Dawla al-Abbasiyya is because of al-Abbas, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These people claimed that the leadership shouldn't be in the Umayyah family, but they must be in Al-Abbas, the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what they did, the first thing that they did, they got support from Iran. And at that time there, Iran was not a Shia yet. They had these seeds of Shia, but they were not full Shia yet. Happens what? They start building little groups and people started being here and there and talking and preparing for the coming of the family of Al-Abbas to rule. Al-Abbas's emblem was black. They wore everything in black. It was their mourning color for the death of the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how they have been mistreated. That's why after that, women in the state of Dawla al-Abbasiyya, which lasted for 500 years, this kingdom of the Bani Abbas, 500 years, Muslims always wore black. This is why the black is a widespread color in the hijab world and things like that. It's because of the impact of Bani al-Abbas, or the family, or the kingdom, or the leadership, or the khilafah of the Abbasiyin. What happened for the transfer of the power from the Bani Umayyah to Bani al-Abbas was extremely horrible. No murders have been committed like that in the name of Islam. For example, the leader, the first founder of the state of Bani al-Abbas, or Dawla al-Abbasiyya, or the Khilafah al-Abbasiyya, his name is Abdullah, and he is called As-Saffah, the blood shedder, or the bloodthirsty man. Do you know why? Because in one night, he invited the majority of Bani Umayyah, what is left of them. And that is not one or two or three, you're talking about thousands. For a party, Banu Umayyah felt something wasn't right, because they knew something was going on in the dark, but they couldn't put their fingers on. So he swore to them, and he swore. And there was this discussion where he swore, and he put the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He promised them their safeguard. It was just a friendly dinner. There was nothing behind it. And he swore, and when they believed him, and they went for the party. And then he closed the gates of his castle and murdered them all, from the first to the last, until his place was just blood and dead corpse. This is why they call him Abdullah As-Saffah. As-Saffah means the shedder of blood, wal-iyadu billah. That's how the Islamic State started then. Of course, this part of history, you will not get to hear it because it's in Arabic. And when they translate it, they belittle the facts. But these things are crucially ugly. Then started the family of Al-Abbasiyin to rule. And as I said, the kingdom went for 500 good and most of it miserable years. In the Dawla Al-Abbasiyya itself, a lot of problems happened. And I'm not going to get into that. But suffice to say that in 1200 years that we have had of history, from the death of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam until the fall of Turkish, the kingdom of Turkish, or the Khilafah of the Turkish, over 250 kings have ruled over Muslim lands. This is unbelievable, and this is without counting Spain. If we go to Spain, we're talking about 350 kings that have ruled the Islamic State for 1,200 years. Let me get my calculator and make the math and come back to you. 1,200 years divided by 350, it gives me 3.42. That is 3.5 kings a year. 3.5 kings a year to rule on Islamic State. That was the most ugly part of the history. I don't want to go into details about the Dawla al-Abbasiyya, but know that the black hijab in the Middle East has nothing to do with the Sunnah. It's more of the impact of the state of Bani al-Abbas, or the Dawla al-Abbasiyya. Then after that, towards the end of the realm of the kingdom of al-Abbasiyyin, what happened is al-Abbasiyyin have transgressed and oppressed so many people in their fights and wars. We have led in history so many unjustified battles. We were really oppressors. And this is a sad fact. This is a sad fact. And so many of them is against us today. And so much of what has happened in the past is in the books of the West. This is why the Western societies, the politicians and everyone, are working very hard so that Muslims never ever get to power, because they don't want to relive the mistakes and the ugliness that we have done in the past. After that, the kingdom got transferred from the Abbasiyyin, the Arabs, to the Turks. And the reason why that happened is because towards the end, the last 100 years of the real ruling of the Abbasiyyin, they started, the kings and all these things, they started marrying beautiful women who came from beyond the river, as they say, Al-Furat, Dajla Al-Furat. And that is the Turks, the beautiful women there. Women who married their kids now, the Arabs now, their blood is mixed now between Arabs and half-breed Arabs. And this is, and at one point there, when the Turks became a young man, they started to become Amir al-Mu'minin, and the kingdom shifted to Turkey. Turkey, again, another 500 years of dark black history. The first thing that they did, the Turks, and so did the Abbasiyin, was to take the Hanafi school of thought as their madhab. That's it. And I will speak in a little bit later about what happened about this part of the school of thought. And in Turkey, something horrible started happening. Creepy thing. You won't believe it, that this was done by a Muslim man who calls himself king, which is okay, no problem, call yourself whatever. But where's Amir al-Mu'minin? Every king. And let me tell you, the Turkish Empire, or the Turkish state, went for 622 years. In these 622 years, 37 kings had ruled. That gives an average of 17 years each. Some of them have even ruled for a day or two, just like some of them for a month or two, whatever. Some have taken a long time. The first thing that a sultan or a sultan did when he got to power, do you know what it is? Is to kill every sibling, male sibling, is to kill them. For instance, if I, Abu Hanifa, I was a sultan of Turkish, and I get to power and I have three brothers, the very first thing I do is kill my three brothers. Cold-bloodedly murder them. Is kill my three brothers so that they don't compete for the power against me, or no coup d'etat or nothing. This is a very dark page in our history. So much so that one of the kings or the sultans of Turkey didn't do it until today. They praise him for not killing his brother. But you know what he did? He put his brother in a forced habitat, i.e. he gave him like a villa or some castle, and that his brother would never, ever leave that castle until the death of the king. Some even killed their own children because there was a battle between the brothers, between the mothers, which child will raise up to the kingdomship. And the king killed this against that. Horrible, horrible, horrible. Very dark times that we had. What did the Turks did after that? The very first thing they started, they had this horrible strategy. And that was every year they would send the army in one direction. For example, we're going to send this to Poland and to a few cities, and they would take any child, boy, that was the age of 10, between the age of 10 and 15, and they would take them and take them to the Asitana, which is Istanbul today. What for? Brainwash, make them enter Islam, and train their loyalty to the king. These kids would never see their parents again. These kids would become the fearsome players in the army of the Turks. Every 2 years, whenever the Turks needed, they would head towards a country. This is why when the battle happens between Bosnia and the different other people, and the Muslims were being murdered there and everything, this is why the West didn't move, because this is a whole history going behind it. Turkey is not being accepted in the West today, even though half of it is in Europe, because of its past. We have conquered so many lands that did not belong to us, and we did it wrong. And the worst thing was in the name of Islam, wal-iyadu billah, in the name of Islam. So as you can see, this is like a few, as I said to you, a few minutes to tell about 1,200 years of century. But anyway, in the Khilafah itself, when we Muslims were super powerful and we had our states, we had so many things happening. Even though the head is Khalifa and Sultan and all that kind of stuff, we had so many different states that broke away from the Islamic state. They didn't want to be under the leadership of one king or Khalifa or whatever. For example, the Dawla al-Ayyubiya, Seljuqiya, al-Mamalik, and so on and so forth. So many of them hated the gods of the Khilafah, and there were battles between Muslims themselves seeking their own independence from each other. It's hardly ever that the Muslims were always one single united body. We have always been a miserable gits, everybody wanting to be the king and the president. And as I said, one day I will speak, inshallah, in details about these types of times, because we need to know. We need to know the truth. This is our history, who we are. To the West, we are bloodthirsty creatures. And as I said before, when you walk into a masjid and you see Muslims sitting there, because we are forced to be peaceful. When Muslims are given the opportunity to express themselves, look at ISIS in Syria and Iraq, and look at these people like in GIA in North Africa, in Algeria, how they used to kill people, Muslims, they don't care. Because it's just they don't believe in what they believe and all that kind of stuff. So my dear brothers and my sisters, when you come now throughout all this history, the political side of the Muslim world is black. It really is dark. This is why the West doesn't want Muslims to get to the power. And they will do anything to prevent us, and rightly so. Because when Muslims get to the power, the first thing they did is misunderstand Islam and launch a war. We start killing people, and this is absolutely wrong, 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 from here until the end of time. Anyway, I come now to the school of thoughts, and what has happened? And why are we where we are today? Very briefly, very briefly. And this is will surprise you, but hey, there is nothing better than the truth. And the nice dose of a shock to the system kind of like a needle. Hey, wake up. It's not always been rosy. At the beginning and for over 200 years, the Muslims, after the death of their Prophet ﷺ, did not have a school of thought. Even though the Sahaba like Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Umar, our mother Aisha and this, they had, these Sahaba were great scholars. They had their own students, like Abdullah ibn Abbas had students in the thousands. In the thousands, they come to study from them. So people from all over town came. But nobody has ever put themselves as, I am a leader of a school of thought. For so many years, everything was fine. Was fine. About 200 years later, when the collection of the ahadith came, a bunch of people, scholars at that time there, and the rulers, made people understand that you are not capable of understanding Islam as Allah wants it, and your understanding must go through a scholar to make sure you understand Islam properly. This made people lose trust in themselves in understanding Islam without any other external influence, just like the companions did. And this was a killer, absolutely a killer. This was the mistake that Allah has warned us in the Quran and the Sunnah against the doings of the children of Israel and again, Isa alayhi salam, from the Jews and what we call today the Christian. Because it no longer was following the religion of Allah, it became following the opinion on how that scholar understood this religion, and that's what we follow. The first one came Al-Imam Abu Hanifa alayhi rahmatullah from Iraq. This man was a man just like you and me, and he had his understanding, and people like his understanding. But the problem that happened is, instead of taking his understanding, the good, and reject the evil, they started following him as a person. He became the leader. And the allegiance of his students and the people who followed him no longer became to what he preached, but to his own individual. It's like a rock and roll band. You like the band. It's either they have a good song or a bad song. You like the band and you don't care about the rest. Then came Imam Malik, and the same problem happened. People, instead of taking what he preached and what he stood for and his understanding, take the good and reject the bad, even though Imam Malik, he said, كُلٌ يُؤْخَذُ مِنْ كَلَامِهِ وَيُرَدْ. Any human on earth, you can take of his words and you can reject his words. إِلَّا صَاحِبُ هَذَا الْقَبْرِ. Except the owner of this grave, and he pointed to the grave of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is the only one we cannot reject his authentic words. Everyone else, I don't care what you say. When it comes to opinion, you're a human, I am a human, end of it. But anyway, people took an Imam Malik alayhi rahmatullah, and that's it, he became the authority. And that's it, what he says. And then little arguments started coming up between the followers of Abu Hanifa and the followers of Imam Malik. And then after that, Imam Shafi'i. And to tell you, Imam Malik was a student of Abu Hanifa. Al-Shafi'i was a student of Imam Malik, and Imam Ahmad was a student of Al-Shafi'i, and they studied together, subhanAllah. But anyway, came Al-Shafi'i, the same thing. Al-Shafi'i had an understanding. So instead of following the understanding and all this and that, they started following him, the person, and then came Imam Ahmad alayhi rahmatullah, and the same problem happened. There were not four school of thoughts. There were over 13 school of thoughts. Some of the leaders, the scholars of that time, were more knowledgeable than these four. But it's just Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give them enough followers. That's it. Otherwise, there were more than 13 school of thoughts. Four of them survived after the Muslims made exactly the same mistake as the Christians. The Christians had so many books, and then they had this church meeting where they decided on the four books that they have today, John, Matthew, Lucas, and whoever the fourth one. This, Muslims, you did the same thing. We had all these 13 school of thoughts, and then the scholars, the ruler of that time, decided that we're only going to follow Abu Hanifa, Malik, Al-Shafi'i, and Ahmed. This would have been okay if people understood, and if these, the scholars and their teachers and their students, made people understand that it is okay to follow somebody else. It's no problem. But no, it became an allegiance business. When you follow the school of thought of the Hanafi, you cannot follow any other school of thought. Even today, the impact of such a horrible, satanic point still exists. Today, you go to somebody who's deadly close on his school of thought, and you tell him, the Sunnah is ABC, and they will look at you, what, do you know better than Abu Hanifa? Are you better than Shafi? You're telling me that you're better than Malik? Who are you? So these people couldn't understand, and you understand today, the scholars of today understand, get lost. A'udhu billah. And this caused us a huge headaches. There were fights, murders, killings, cheatings, poisonings in the name of school of thoughts. Yes, a lot of times a school of thought would contradict the other school of thought just because there are two different school of thoughts. Go beat that thing there. We have some issues, some things in our books of history that have been written in the matter of knowledge. Wallahi al-azim, you will not believe that a Muslim scholar would write that just because they don't agree. I'll give you an example of this calamity that has caused Muslims the dark ages, which we don't hear about in the Muslim history. Al-istithna fil iman. Al-istithna is when you say, insha'Allah, when you say, I am a believer. If someone asks you, are you a believer? What do you say? You say, yes, I am. Some others, they say, yes, insha'Allah. Well, as simple as this can be, because if you say, are you a believer, from what I know from myself, yes, I am. I believe in Allah, the books and things. I fulfill the criteria of the iman. But does Allah see me as a believer? Allah knows best. So if I say, yes, insha'Allah, I'm talking from how Allah looks at me. If I say, yes, with full mouth, that's I'm talking about myself. Well, guess what? This is not as simple as it is until today between the school of thought. Look at it. The Hanafi school of thought, they say you must say yes without insha'Allah. Because if you say insha'Allah, they mean you are in doubtful. You don't know if you are a Muslim, a believer or not. And if you are like this, then you disbelieve. The Shafi'i school of thought, they say no. When you say, I am a believer, say insha'Allah. Because who are you to decide for yourself that you are a believer or not? You know where this issue led? To books upon books written against this, on this subject. Worse, in one part in our life, it was not permissible for a follower, if a woman was a Shafi'i and the man was a Hanafi, it was haram in the school of thoughts of the Hanafi that the man marries a woman of the Shafi'i school of thought. Strange, huh? But it happened. It happened. It was haram on a man to marry a Muslim who is Shafi'i. And then when this became, come on, hang on, we can marry a Jew and we can marry a Christian, and we can't marry a Muslim woman who says, La ilaha illallah. Then some of the scholars of the Hanafi school of thought, they said, you can marry a woman who is of the Shafi'i school of thought, but on one condition, you must treat her and consider her like a Jew or Christian. Na'udhu billah. Na'udhu. Yes, this happened in the Abbasi times. In the Abbasi times. And guess what? Worse, when the Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab of the Saudi Arabia came, alayhi rahmatullah, you know what happened? There are some old pictures of Al-Kaaba now, where they, every angle, every side of Al-Kaaba, the Kaaba has four sides, right? Every side of Al-Kaaba had a minbar. Every school of thought led its salat separately from the other one. So this is how it would happen. The Shafi'i school of thought would pray first. Then when they finish, the Maliki. And when they finish the Hanafi school of thought, then on the fourth position comes the Hanbali school of thought. This went on, believe it or not, for 8 centuries, 800 years. It started on the 4th century and it went on until Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, about 200 years ago, when he came to launch his religious reform battle, whatever you want to call it. But let me tell you a little bit more. For 800 years, Mecca, the Haram, had 15 imams from the different school of thoughts. And they had 21 Jum'ah Khatib, the one, the preacher who gives the khutbah, there were 21 of them. For the silent salawat, there was no problem. Each one led their salat silent. But if for Maghrib, for example, it was a chaos. Because imagine all four school of thoughts for Maghrib, because the time is narrow. The Hanafi, the Maliki, all of them, they prayed together and it was a mess. This imam reciting Quran here, the other one there. It was a complete chaos. So let's take it like this. At Maghrib time, because the time is narrow, what happens is the four school of thought, they all get together and they start praying at the same time. This imam is reciting Al Quran, different surah. And the other one is reciting another Quran, different surah. And then one of them says, Allahu Akbar. And the other ones, for example, from the other school of thought, here is Allahu Akbar. He thinks his imam says Allahu Akbar. They make ruku'. The other ones are actually still reciting Al Quran. The other one says, Sami Allahu liman hamida. The other one is making sujood. And it was a complete joke. The salat, it was a complete problem for a salat. This went on for 8 long dark 100 years, 800 years, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, the reformist, and he annihilated all these problems. And for the last 200 years, Mecca has got one Imam at the same time, but still the Imams are under the boots of the governors. That's why in Mecca, even till today, the Imams still read from a paper, because it comes written from the government. This is the dark times. They're still going on, and I pray to Allah to help us elevate them. Anyway, let's carry on. Furthermore, it's really bizarre. Look at this one here. This school of thoughts would not perform the salat until they make their own adhan the way they believe in it, when they do it, and perform the salat on their terms and conditions. It was easy to reject a hadith. It was very easy to throw it against the wall, to throw this ayah against the wall. Why? The loyalty lied for their school of thoughts. It's my school of thoughts or Jahannam. That's the end of it. It's madness. It is madness. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished the Muslims time after time. And this is why Allah sent the Mongols, Genghis Khan, to punish the Muslims like no end. No end. Let me tell you how the Mongols attacked our lands. Why Allah caused in one day 1 million Muslims got slaughtered in Baghdad. One day, 1 million Muslims slaughtered by the Mongols. And you know what Genghis Khan did at the end of the day? He gathered all the skulls, the heads of the Muslims, and he built a platform. On that platform there, they put just the clothing. They didn't even bother to put the wood. And he established a big throne, and he was having dinner on the carcasses, the head carcasses of Muslims. 1 million Muslims slaughtered like lamb. Do you know why? I'll tell you why. Because in the books of history, we always tell the Mongols attacked us, and we always think like we are the poor guys. Well, actually, it's not. Because the Muslims were completely heedless, and they didn't care about a clear warning of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as reported in Sunan Abi Dawud and An-Nasa'i and Al-Bayhaqi. This hadith is authentic, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Utruku at-Turka ma tarakukum." Leave the Turks as long as they leave you alone. Don't instigate them. Don't go and look for trouble with the Turks. If they attack us, we have to defend ourselves, but we should not instigate the battle. But look what the Muslims did and how the calamity befell them for going against one teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when they shouldn't have. And the consequences, wal-iyadu billah, are felt until our day today. It happened that one day some merchants came from Mongolia to do business in Baghdad. And what happened is, these people got murdered. The Mongolians got murdered. There were about four merchants. Genghis Khan heard that his merchants were dead. So he sent a delegation of about seven people to go to Baghdad to ask the Khalifa, the Muslim Khalifa, as to why, what has happened. He wanted to know, how did his merchants die? Who killed them? What happened? You know what the Khalifa did? Instead of listening to this, the Khalifa killed the messengers. The Khalifa did what? Killed the messengers. Subhanallah. That is the case? Yes, that is the case. Genghis Khan heard of this. Genghis Khan didn't have an idea about the world. And obviously he started saying he spies, and he did this and he did that. And then he attacked the Muslim world like a calamity hammer falling on the Muslim world. They didn't know where that came from. In one day, 1 million people in Baghdad got slaughtered like lambs. Like lambs. That is the price of oppression. But in any case, the Muslims, as I said, were like four great school of thoughts. As much as in some school of thought, this is halal and the other one is haram. And people started getting confused. To save people from confusion, they say, look, when you are a normal day-to-day Muslim, take a school of thought and stick to it. Big mistake. Because when you take one school of thought, you have taken 25% out of 75%. And people's allegiance started getting built on what? What kind of school of thought are you today? Look today in the Muslims. You go to some masajid, the sunnah, Bukhari, Muslim, the whole sunnah says, go left, and they would go right. They don't care about what the sunnah, authentic sunnah, says. This is one of the problems we have today. Saudi Arabia is Hanbali school of thought designed to their own likings. What they like, they do. What they don't like, they don't do. And what they don't like, they will go to the extremes to turn the text, mutilate them, torture them, twist their necks until it means what they want to mean. Na'udhu billah. They did a plan. That plan is meticulously prepared. The Hanbali, they say Al-Mughni is our book of Ibn Qudama, good. But when you look at it, you find that they contradict a lot of it because it doesn't suit Islam since the fall of Ali radiallahu anhu. And his killings has never been the Islam that Allah likes. It has always been a politicized Islam, and Saudi Arabia is no different. If you look at the history, how the Saudi family came to power, so much blood, so much killings, so much betrayal, so much treasons, so much and so much and so much. Well, the scholars at that time covered so much of the wrongdoings of the Al Saud. A bargain deal was struck between the family of Al Saud and Al Sheikh. The agreement was that the Al Sheikh will take care in educating people about Islam and everything, and Al Saud will run the country. But as long as the religion does not interfere with what the Al Saud do, okay, you can talk. This is why in Saudi Arabia today, they will talk to you about the beard, they will talk to you about Isbal, shorten your clothes, they will talk to you about this, but they will never, ever put an emphasis on, for example, how the government, where is the money that the government gets out of the petrol? Do you know, for example, that any money that the government gets out of selling the resources of the country, like here the petrol, there must be a zakat on it, and that zakat must be paid to the poor people. In Saudi Arabia, there are huge millions of number of people that extremely broke. They don't have. Saudi Arabia, as the name indicates, exists to celebrate the kingdom of the Saudis. They don't care about the people. Here is another hadith that you never hear. In Al-Bukhari and Muslim, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam explicitly says, من ادعى إلى غير أبيه وهو يعلم أنه غير أبيه فالجنة عليه حرام. In the meaning of this is, whoever claims that he is the son of another person that is not his father, and he knows that person is not his father, al-jannah will be haram on that person, i.e. he will be punished extremely heavily in hellfire before going to Jannah at the end of his life. In another hadith, any man that associates with him with another tribe and that tribe is not his, he is also cursed. Now, in Saudi Arabia, there are plenty of people that are not of the family of Al Saud. Yet, every passport said you are a Saudi. Scholars never talk about this issue. And it's a huge, dangerous issue, because it goes right against the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, where it is haram to belong to a tribe and take a name of it when you are not part of that tribe. But the scholars would never ever bring these issues and many other issues of that. For example, let's not get into much example, because here is about a brief history. One other day, I'll get into details about these issues, inshallah. Even today, in Saudi Arabia, as long as you sing a song for the king, you can be the greatest imam. They make a celebrity out of you. But open your mouth. There are thousands, my brothers and my sisters, realize this big problem. There are thousands upon thousands of dedicated shuyukh in jails in Saudi Arabia. Some of them more than 20 years, nobody knows anything about them. Even one of the scholars that was in jail, Ali, he's still alive, he wrote to the king a documentary. It's on the internet and it is in Arabic, where he says the amount of trouble that he has gone to. Would you believe that a Muslim scholar who fears Allah and speaks about the truth gets taken to jails in Saudi Arabia and have his beard shaved and they make them sit on bottles? Would you believe that they break bottles and they treat these people like that? There was a Muslim person that I personally know who spent 7 years in a Saudi jail, an Englishman. Why? Because one day he said something and they bundled up to jail. And he said, in one day I was being tortured. And the torturer told you, and this man said to the guy, fear Allah. The man, he said, if Allah comes down, I will punish him too. Na'udhu billah, na'udhu billah. Don't think about these big titles that they give to the king of Saudi Arabia, Khadim al-Haramain, the servant of the two Haramain, Mecca and al-Madina. This is putting a glitter color in front of our eyes, so don't attack them. There are tons of ahadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks against tyrants and against scholars who washes up to the kings, but we never get to hear them, because you will not, because this doesn't serve the preps well. Under the name of safeguarding the blood of Muslims, the kings are doing what they could doing. ISIS is being supported by Saudi Arabia. Reports are being all over town. Why? Why all these murders? And then what they did this rule in Saudi Arabia that, subhanAllah, this rule applies only to Saudi Arabia. In Egypt, subhanAllah, Al-Azhar, you can criticize any scholar. No, he's wrong, he said, in North Africa, anywhere except in Saudi Arabia. If you open your mouth to say that scholar is wrong, they will tell you the flesh of a scholar is poisonous. Don't talk about him. Don't talk about him. And at that, they created a generation of people that can't even utter their mouth. Subhanallah, they can't even utter their mouth in disagreement with the scholar. I one day was on the internet, on YouTube, watching, and this Saudi sheikh gives this fatwa. It is haram. And I nearly ate my laptop. They asked him, what is halal from a man to another man? What can we see from each other? Man to man. I'm talking to my brother, to my friend at home. What can I see of him? Do you know what he said? He said, what you can see of your brother male is exactly what you can see of a woman. They said to him, but a woman wears the niqab. He told them, well, you should grow a long beard and you must not let him, like, for example, according to him, seeing the forearm of your Muslim brother man is haram. Wallahi al-Azim, this is craziness. Why? Because they have a sexuality problem in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is the worst place to be a woman and a young boy. It's the worst place on earth. The impact of, and then came the other now point where I want to end my talk here, is some people, they start calling themselves the Salafi. Even though Saudi Arabia and the Shuyukh, they dress in a certain way. If you don't dress like that way, it's not your Salaf. What does being a Salafi means? A Salaf is anyone that has gone past you. And what we usually refer is the group of the Sahaba under the leadership of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in Saudi Arabia, they say, we follow our Salaf and this Salaf and that Salaf. But you know what Salaf means to them? Grow a very long beard, don't touch it, and wear a qamis halfway below your knees, and the siwak, and that's it. Subhanallah. A Salaf means we have to act Islam just like a Sahaba did it. But since when this is the truth in Saudi Arabia, who now is taking the world like we are the representative of Islam? That is a big lie. What they have made in the last 30 years, and I have been witness to that, and I did fight as long as I lived, and I still will fight that. What we are being promoted today is not the Islam of the Salaf, the true Salaf. It's not. It's the Islam of the Saudi Arabia to protect their own kingdom. Today we have Muslims here, they are completely confused. They don't know which Islam to go, right or left. They don't know. Subhanallah, I hear sometimes when I do my research for simple things. For example, I'll give you an example. You remember when I made my talk about how far can a woman travel alone? And remember about the 24-hour rule, right? Well, Ibn Uthaymeen, Shaykh al-Fawzan, Ibn Baz, every scholar of this say exactly what I told you, that a woman can travel alone for the duration of 24 hours. Beyond that, she can't. But you know what? When you go and make a research or ask for the fatwa in Saudi Arabia, they will tell you it's haram for her to move an inch. Hang on. The big scholars, Ibn Uthaymeen, Ibn Baz, say it's halal. But you know what? Because they have this in Saudi Arabia, they have this sickness of a woman, if she's alone for a split of a second, 10 men are going to jump, rape her. Because that's the personality of who they are. They are freaks when it comes to the interaction between men and women. Throughout history, we have paid a huge amount when Islam got hijacked politically, and it still is hijacked politically, and it's still so many ahadith never took place, and they are pushed in the books of hadith. When you read them, they contradict the Quran, yet people cannot reject them because they are in the books of hadith. It's a long, long, long headache out there. There is a huge battle happening these days where Muslims say, enough is enough. We don't want a politicized Islam any longer. We want a good Islam, just like the old good days. I don't want. But subhanAllah, wallahi al-azim, the other night I'm listening to some talks. Sometimes they give me heart attacks when I hear to these things. But anyway, this is just a brief history about who we are, what we are, just like to give you an idea. We have had some nice little 5 years here, not even 5 years, time here, time there, time there. But as a whole, it's not something we can be proud of. Our history is not something we can be proud of. So before we laugh at Europe for the Dark Ages, before we make fun of these countries, before we make fun, we should and ought take a look at our own history. This is why Allah in Al-Quran says, "Ud'u ila sabili rabbik," call to Allah. Don't call to our science. Don't call to what we have accomplished. We have accomplished a little bit here, a little bit there, a little bit here, and Allah has made it that it leaves a big impact. But when you look at our history, I really, really wish you that you have a night's sleep without any nightmares. Allah al-Azim, it brings me to subhanAllah. But in any case, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us get to the best way. Stick to this group. I will be, idhnillah tabaraka wa ta'ala, lead you to the best of Islam. No politics, no influence of Saudi Arabia, no influence of any Arabian or non-Arabian. Just the Islam of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam as he said it, taken from the books of our real predecessors, without any play, without any change, from the good old Arabic, not from the mouth of somebody who works for a government or somebody who's getting paid to preach Islam, but from the book where he took himself. And this is why I always read the text in Arabic and give you the translation of it. Because there is a lot of nonsense being promoted there by the long-bearded satellite TV sheikhs. Wallahi al-azim. And anyone who opens his mouth is in jail. Let me give you a golden rule. Any sheikh today, in Saudi Arabia specifically, that talks and is widely open, know very well that he is agreed upon by the ruling family. The latest one, Abdul Aziz Al-Arif, may Allah release him. Well, subhanAllah, a woman calls him on the phone live. She said, "Ya Sheikh," and I have the video. "Ya Sheikh," she tells him, "my husband has been in jail for 9 years with no reason. He has not even been to the court of law. I can't go visit him. They prevent me from going to visit him." And she says he is abused sexually, emotionally. And he did nothing. He's absolutely a beautiful man. She goes, "Ya Sheikh, why am I being tortured like this? Everywhere I go, the doors are closed." And then the Sheikh said there that the jails in Saudi Arabia, there is a long oppression, transgression, and this and this and this. Couple days later, he got jailed. And then when he got jailed, we don't hear anything from him. Now it's been more than 5 months. Nobody knows nothing about him, not his family, nobody. And you know what the horrible creatures of the hypocrites did of these rulers? The next day they put him in jail because this man is famous. Abdul Aziz Al-Arifi, Allah yahfadhu, may Allah safeguard him. You know what they did? The next day they called all these big sheikhs, all these internet sheikhs, Facebook sheikhs that are promoted by the Saudi government. Nowadays our sheikhs have become celebrities with number of followers on YouTube, on Facebook, on their appearances, and when they go, subhanAllah, if one of the sheikhs this comes to London or that sheikh, television sheikh comes to London, people flock in the masjid with thousands upon thousands. Other people use these sheikhs to generate funds, to raise money. Subhanallah, the Islam has become a business. Islam has become a number of followers. These sheikhs are used and manipulated by the government of Saudi Arabia. They promote the sheikh like he's a big shot on television and everything. Calls are filtered and recorded before they reach the sheikh because they don't want people to ask the sheikh when he's taking a question and answer sessions, questions that relate to the government or anything that the Saudi government doesn't want. Subhanallah. Anyway, to cover up for the arrest of Sheikh Abdul Aziz Al-Arifi, this future king invited all them internet and satellite sheikhs to a dinner the next day, and he took pictures with Facebook, Twitter, and all their media contact and management, and Sheikh Abdul Aziz Al-Arifi, the one that was dear and loved to them, they not even mention his name once. What happens to him doesn't matter. The paycheck matters. This type of celebrities and scholars have caused a havoc throughout the history, the 1200 years of our history. They are not something new, they have changed. The media has changed, the purpose is the same. Use Islam for political ends, not for Allah's ends. Even if they use Allah's name and Allah's religion as what's in front of your eyes. Purpose behind closed door politics. Wallahi al-Azim, it's pure hypocrisy. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has got plans. And one day he's going to bust the people of Saudi Arabia with their scholars until the last one. They will all have. Now, if we talk against them, the first thing they're going to say, ha-ha, this man is a deviated group. He's a Mu'tazila. This man is a poisonous. This one wants to differentiate between the Muslim. This one. A'udhu billah from all these lies. If that is what's going to cost us the price to break free, we'll do it. We'll do it. We have to stand up, my dear brothers and my sisters, for this beautiful Islam that's been hijacked for 1,200 years by the ruling families. This is your brother, Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. Please do leave comments, notes, ask questions and everything. This is our history in few minutes. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me life, and I will one day deal with our history. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.